This is Philadelphia Eagles Now. I'm Chase Sr. Thanks for rocking and rolling with us. So many content options out there. So anytime you stop by, we greatly appreciate your support. Coming up on the Eagles Now rundown, A.J. Brown sounding off. He called into Sports Radio 94 WIP on Friday afternoon to discuss all of the drama around the Philadelphia Eagles. And my first thought here, you have to give A.J. Brown a lot of credit. Rarely does a star player, star athlete, call into a radio station pretty much unprompted to defend himself, clear up some rumors, defend the team, and then he called out the radio station for spreading rumors. So I want to go through some of my biggest A.J. Brown interview takeaways. And the big one, which a lot of fans have been concerned about, is A.J. Brown going to ask out? He's had some sideline spats. It seemed as though he was frustrated. He didn't speak with the media at the end of the year, even though he said it wasn't personal. Does A.J. Brown want to stay with the Eagles? And that was the first question that Ike Reese, former Eagles linebacker and special teams ace, asked him. And A.J. Brown said this, got right to it, wasted no time. I have no problem. I want to be here. It's as simple as that. I love where I'm at. It's as simple as that. Next question. And I love how A.J. Brown, when he's asked that first question, hits WIP with next question. Leaves no meat on the bone. He leaves no speculation out there to be had. He got right to the point, addressed it, and said, I want to be a Philadelphia Eagle. And that's really important for this organization. A.J. Brown, in his 2 years in Philadelphia, has had the best two-year stretch for any wide receiver in the history of this great organization. And you think about where the Eagles were before they traded for A.J. Brown. Jalen Reagor, flop. Travis Fulgham had a couple of really good games. Those were some of the Eagles' top options at wide receiver before A.J. Brown. Pretty sad if you ask me. And you make the draft night trade and you give up really nothing of value for a player of this caliber. And in his first year, he sets the record for the most receiving yards in the history of the organization with almost 1,500. That comes on 145 targets, 88 grabs. He had 11 touchdowns, yards per catch, 17. He was also terrific in the Super Bowl. And then in 2023, the Eagles' offense went downhill, but A.J. Brown did not. Remember those six games in a row where he had 125-plus yards? He was targeted a lot, 158. I thought it could have been more because Brian Johnson went away from him later in the year. 106 catches. Once again, almost 1,500 yards. Touchdowns went down by 4. Yards per catch went down to 13.7 because the Eagles' offense wasn't as explosive. But A.J. Brown is a special blend of height, speed, strength, able to break tackles, pull away from defenders, come down with 50-50 balls. He's the closest thing that this organization has had since Terrell Owens. Number two, A.J. Brown wanted to discuss and address how he's perceived by fans as well as the media. And it's easy for people to misconstrue some of these sideline conversations that look to get emotional. Some people have identified A.J. Brown as a drama queen and a diva. Here's what he had to say. I'm the person you need on this team, because I am willing to hold people accountable, make people around me better. But nobody sees that. All you see is the little flare-ups. Nobody on that building works harder than me. I can stand on that, and I can say that. A.J. Brown, by saying that, is standing on business. And when you're in as good of shape as A.J. Brown is, when you got drafted to play Major League Baseball, start at Ole Miss, start with the Titans, start with the Eagles, you don't get to that spot without working hard. You see the craft. You see him in the lab. He's a great route runner. He's been durable for this team outside of the fluky injury in Week 18 against the New York Giants. And he's very well respected across the entire locker room. So what people see in the public eye isn't always what somebody is behind the scenes. And I guarantee you, if you asked a lot of players in that Eagles locker room, who works really hard? Who's the hardest worker? They might say, A.J. Brown. And I like the confidence that he has in himself. More on that, he said, I'm never going to stop being myself. I'm never going to shy away or be afraid to speak out. And that's how I'm going to be until I'm 6 feet underground. I had the balls to call into this show and explain myself. If I don't talk to the media, it's just that I don't want to. That's juicy stuff right there. And he called out WIP for spreading some of those rumors. But look, I'm giving him credit because it does take balls on an off day in the middle of the off season to call a radio station because you don't know what they're going to ask you. You know that you're going to have to address a lot of the controversies around you. It's not easy. He didn't need to do this. He still did. And that's leadership right there to a certain degree. A.J. Brown also touched on the state of Philadelphia media. And there's a big, like, ex-Twitter controversy right now. He called the station out for spreading those rumors. There's this Twitter scandal because remember at the end of the year how A.J. Brown deactivated his Twitter? And then there were rumblings about somebody taking his username and then activating that Twitter again or using the same handle. And then he was tweeting out some stuff during the Super Bowl. Then Darius Slay had to tweet out, I called AJ. He said it's not him. AJ Brown did say, I deactivated my Twitter. Somebody else had the handle, but it is me now. And it seems as though he did call the Philadelphia media lame. And the media landscape that we're in is a very interesting one. It is about clicks. It's about drawing viewers and grabbing attention. So when there's a report out there or there's a juicy rumor, people are going to talk about it. Now, I like to talk about it here on the show. One, that's my job. Two, I like to have thought-provoking conversations because the people who I grew up listening to and the best broadcasters that I know are the ones who got the wheels churning in between my ears and made me think. Colin Cowherd, SVP, Dan Patrick. Nowadays, Joe Rogan. I think that Tucker Carlson has some fascinating interviews from time to time because he makes people think. That's not a look into my political preferences, but I like to listen to people who challenge others' opinions, who like to have open-minded conversations, but sometimes the media can run with these little narratives and things can get taken out of context. Here's A.J. Brown's take on that. I'm not trying to change the media. I know it's been like this, and it'll be like this when I leave. I just think I'm so misunderstood. Everyone wants to paint me as a diva. I yell on the sidelines, and y'all assume it's about targets. What if I'm holding people accountable? Y'all just assume it's anger? And I think I bring a good perspective to this show. A lot of you see me here on the program. We like to have a lot of fun during watch parties. We'll take down some drinks. We'll chop it up. We'll laugh. We'll joke around. Sometimes here inside the walls of Chat Sports, things can get heated. Sometimes people can get fired up. If producer Chip's not doing his job, I got to tell him because that affects the product that we put on the air. And every single day, I try to be thought-provoking and provide informative, entertaining, insightful content. And I try my best to live up to that standard every single day. And if I'm not doing that, I should call myself out. If somebody else isn't doing that here at Chat Sports under the Chat Sports brand, that's a little bit of an issue. And if A.J. Brown is holding his teammates accountable, like any of us should hold their significant others accountable, friends accountable, coworkers accountable, there's nothing wrong with that. And sometimes things do get spirited at work, at home, on the sideline. And for me, I worked in television. I've worked in radio. I've worked in news. I've worked in sports. Now I'm on YouTube, digital. And I get how this business works, right? And I get the current landscape of the media. You want to know why I got out of news media, news television? Oftentimes, there's a narrative that's trying to be pushed by people who are leaning on one side as compared to the other. And if something fits that narrative and those talking points, boom, they're going to run with it. There's a saying out there, if it bleeds, it leads. Meaning, if it's a nasty story, it always starts off the newscast. Why? Grabs your attention right from the jump. And going back to AJ calling WIP, WIP is a legacy station in Philadelphia. I remember growing up listening to WIP every day. Howard Eskin. I would go to sleep on one of those old school looking radios, and I would fall asleep listening to WIP. I've wanted to be in this business as a sports broadcaster since I was 5 years old. And for them, to have this interview. Obviously, it's huge for them, but they call Eagles games. They're the flagship station. Eagles games are broadcast on WIP, so this is a big deal for AJ to call them and also have this conversation. Now, you never want to get on the media's bad side, and you never want to be the person who pouts and points fingers and tries to deflect blame off of you. It's part of the reason why a lot of people had an issue with Donovan McNabb in this city. He never took the blame and never said, you know what, as the face of the franchise, as the quarterback, I made a mistake, I got to be better. It was always something else. And you never want to rip the fan base, because the media last year in 2022 was hyping you up. The fan base loves you. They're hyping you up. They can give you a lot of praise, but here in Philadelphia, if things aren't going well, yeah, fans are going to be juiced up and fired up about it. But I wish that every athlete in this city had the mental process and the appreciation for the fans and the understanding of what Philadelphia is all about, kind of like a Bryce Harper who just gets it. More to come on this, but first, you give A.J. Brown props for doing this. P for props. D, if you think that he's still a diva, I don't think he does this seeking attention. He does this to set the record straight. Eagles Now, by the way, is sponsored by Prize Picks, making daily fantasy sports easy. And Prize Picks is the number one DFS app and the largest independently run daily fantasy sports app in North America. You pick two or more players, you choose more or less on the projected stat lines, and you get a $100 deposit match. PrizePicks.com/CLNS. Use the code CLNS. I'm going to hop into my baseball bag here. Austin Riley, more than 35.5 jacks. Freddie Freeman, more than 26.5 homers. Freddie Freeman, also more than 176.5 hits. He's just a hitting machine. Ronald Acuna, more, the reigning MVP, than 37.5 home runs. And then Aaron Nola, Philadelphia Phillies, more than 195.5 strikeouts. If that sounds fun, I guarantee you it is. You can win up to 25 times your money with Prize Picks. PrizePicks.com/CLNS. Continue to keep it moving here on the A.J. Brown front. He was asked, is the locker room fractured? And he expanded on this, and when you lose 7 of 8 games, everybody thinks the sky is falling. And in Philadelphia, with how seriously the people take the Eagles, how passionate they are about this team, it seemed as though the sky was falling. He said, the locker room is fine. Players just weren't executing. Media ran with the coaches, blame the coaches. I'm not going to blame the coaches. It was the players not executing. People asking, what happened? What happened? We were never really playing like the best team in the league. We had the best record in the league, but we were scratching it out. Later on, it was just a domino effect, and we couldn't stop the bleeding. A.J. Brown was one of the players who defended Nick Sirianni, and he said, it's on us. It's not on the coaching staff. Now, Britton Covey did say sometimes the message wasn't getting through from coach to player. And players, though, were pointing fingers at one another. I thought the play calling for Brian Johnson was bad. I thought the offensive scheme from Sirianni was vanilla, mundane and boring, not creative at all. But the players were also shooting themselves in the foot with turnovers. A.J. Brown had one in Dallas. With penalties, Jordan Mailata, many of them. Just missed opportunities. And that Eagles 10-1 start, it was flawed. Like, they were eking out games, and they didn't play a solid game from start to finish literally all year long. You know, they had to pull one out on the road at FedEx Field against Washington. Minnesota nearly came back early. Patriots game week 1 was ugly. You think about how they won that Chiefs game. If Marquez Valdez-Scantling comes down with that football, do the Eagles lose? They come down from 17 against the Buffalo Bills. And then the San Francisco 49ers really just, I thought, mentally and physically broke them, and they never recovered after that. So that 10-1 start, it was a little bit flawed, because all year we were like, something seems off. Something ain't right. And this Eagles team just isn't playing up to their caliber. And then lastly, anger versus passion. Is A.J. Brown angry, or is he just passionate? And his sideline situations were never and have never been to the likes of like Odell Beckham Jr., who's a straight-up drama queen. For A.J. Brown, he may have disagreed with some others. He may have been holding other people accountable. There's nothing wrong with that. Here's his perspective. What if my flare-ups on the sidelines are because I care too much and I want to hold people accountable and get them back up? Y'all just don't see it from Jalen because that's not his personality, but it's mine. And I can do that because nobody works as hard as me, puts the work in like me, and I stand on that. Y'all take it as anger, it's passion. Naturally, wide receivers are always perceived as divas. Jason Kelce has flipped out on the sideline many times. You want to go to another team? Tom Brady has flipped out on his teammates many a times. And people don't always make that a big deal because it's a quarterback, or in Kelce's sense, it's a center. But wide receivers are always perceived as divas and prima donnas. And keep in mind, the NFL salary cap is going up to $255 million because numbers continue to be stupid. What were the Super Bowl numbers? An average of 125 million people are watching at one time for Niners Chiefs. Most watched telecast ever. And if you look at the top 100 TV events over the last calendar year, about 90% of them are pretty much all the NFL. So the NFL and NFL broadcasts are a form of entertainment. It's a form of drama. It is a soap opera to a certain degree. So from somebody who's on camera but also knows how things happen behind the scenes, I guarantee you that after an Eagles 3-and-out, there is a cameraman who the producer is in the ear of like this, telling them, I need a one shot on A.J. Brown and I need you to follow him on the entire sideline. And as soon as a disagreement happens, as soon as A.J. Brown is emotional, doing anything like that, they're going to cut to that on the broadcast. Why? Gets people talking. That adds intrigue to the product. The good news in all of this is, from A.J. Brown calling WIP, is that A.J. Brown wants to be an Eagle. A.J. Brown wants to be on this football team. And again, think about the days of J.J. Arcega-Whiteside, Travis Fulgham, Jalen Reagor, when Quez Watkins was a number two, when Jonathan Hightower was on this football team as one of the wide receivers who some fans thought had a chance. Those days, they were rough. Now the Eagles have A.J. Brown and Devontae Smith, one of the best wide receiver duos in the National Football League. Can't take it for granted. If you want daily coverage of the Birds, go Birds, of course, but hit that subscribe button down below. Thanks to everybody for watching the show. Hope you enjoyed it here today.